Hello, welcome to the first video lecture of SEM 2, Structural Equation Modeling. In this course, we're going to go into much more mathematical, methodological detail behind structural equation modeling. And we're going to extend the CFA framework to the SEM framework, where we also have direct effects between latent variables or observed variables. And in this video, I want to explain the logic behind expectation algebra and covariance algebra. And I thought I'll just make a video lecture out of this, just like I did a video lecture on the stats recap in SEM 1. Most of this is just a lot of practice, and then you sort of get the hang of it. And once you get the hang of it, it's a really useful set of tools to determine what implied covariances and expectations follow from your SEM model. So here's a very basic SEM model. It's very similar to what we saw in SEM 1, with one exception. X here is now observed. So we have a regression between two observed variables. And later in the course, we'll make them latent again. So we have two variables here, X and Y. And X is what we will call an exogenous variable, or an independent variable, which means that we don't explain X itself. X is simply X. It has a variance and it has a mean. It has a variance of sigma x squared. This is the standard deviation. And it has a mean of mu x. And y is explained by x. So we have a regression model for y. Y equals beta times x plus the residual in epsilon. And I did not draw the intercept here, but you can also include the intercept tau. So y equals tau plus beta times x plus the residual. And this residual also has a standard deviation in theta. In the univariate form, we usually denote this with standard deviations. In the multivariate form, with variances. That's a bit confusing sometimes. So this is the standard deviation. So this model implies a certain causal model for y. And we can fit this model to the variance covariance structure and the mean structure, just like we fitted our CFA model. We have five observations. We have a variance of x, we have a variance of y, a covariance between the two. Those three we observe. And then we also have a mean of y and a mean of x. We also have five parameters. We want to estimate this standard deviation or variance of x, the mean of x, this beta, this intercept tau, and finally this variance or standard deviation of the residual. So we have five knowns, five unknowns, which means that we have a saturated model, which means that we can estimate these parameters. Now we can do that just like in CFA by looking at the implied variance structure and the implied mean structure, and then optimizing our parameters so that the implied structure most closely resembles the observed structure. For the variance covariance structure, we can find that the implied structure is this. The variance of x is simply the variance of x. The variance of y equals beta squared times the variance of x plus the variance of the residual. And the covariance between the two equals beta times the variance of x. For the mean structure, or the expected values, we will find this. The expected value of y, or the mean of y, equals tau plus the regression coefficient times the means of x. And the mean of x is simply the mean of x. Now that's all nice, but why is this the case? And this is what this video is about. In the end of this video, you should be able to do this yourself as well. And it's also a good practice then to try these things. Now first I'll take a bit of a detour. And instead of talking about SEM models and regression models, I'll talk about games and gambling. So suppose someone offers you to play the following game. You throw a dice, and if you throw a 6, you win 6 euros. But if you throw any other number, you will pay 1 euro. So I have a dice, I'll throw it, I get either 6 and I win 6, or I get anything else and I lose 1 euro. Would this be a smart game to play, statistically? So maybe now you want to pause the video and then think about this before we continue. Alright, so would this be smart? And to solve this problem, we need to look at the expected value. Now, this is a very nice expression to compute the expected value. This means the average amount that we expect to obtain from our chance experience. In this case, we're talking about money. The expected value of a random variable we can compute by summing for every possible outcome variable the amount times the probability that we would get that amount. So in this case, we have two outcome variables. We have an outcome variable that we win 6 euros times the probability of 1 over 6. And we have one outcome variable that we lose 1. So we have plus 6 times probability 1 over 6 minus 1, because we would lose 1, times probability of 5 over 6. And if we fill this in, you can see that that would be 1 over 6, the result. So it would be 0.166666, etc., etc., etc. Which means that on average, we would expect to win 16 cents. Now, of course, we would never exactly win 16 cents. We would either win 6 euro or we'd lose 1 euro. But this expected value will tell me that if I would do this game a million times, I would expect to win this value times a million, because I repeated my experiment a million times. And if you simulate this, it will actually be pretty close. So in this case, it would be a pretty smart game to play, because we would expect to win money. That is, if you like money, of course. So we should play this game. Now here's another game that you might have seen before. We have this roulette board. In this case, it's a casino game. There's a ball that goes around in this little oval thingy here. It will roll, it will roll, it will roll. This thing will also turn, and at some point it will fall into a hole. It might fall into like 17. And then that's the outcome. And before we did this, before we threw this ball, we can bet on this field. And we can bet on all kinds of things. You can bet on the number, you can bet on even or odd, red or black, one of the three rows, etc., etc., etc. Now, if we would bet on the number, and the number would fall, so say we bet 17 and the number 17 would fall, we would win 35 times our bet. And all these areas have different outcomes. If you would bet on red or black, we would win 2 times our bet, basically. So should we play this game? So maybe now you want to pause the video again and think about this. What the expected value would be of betting, say, 1 euro on this game and betting on one number, say, number 17. Okay, so should we play this game? So we can, again, just compute the expected value. Suppose we bet 1 euro, there are 37 squares on which this ball can fall, because we have 1 to 36, but we also have this number 0. And this number 0 is hugely important. If this number 0 was not there, the game would be fair. You would get an expected value of 0, which means that on average you would not win or lose money. But the 0 is there. And this will put the game in favor of the casino. So we have a 1 over 37 chance of getting 35 euro, 35 times our bet, because there are 1 out of 37 whole squares here will be the number 17, minus 36 over 37 times 1. So we have a 36 over 37 probability that we would lose 1 euro. And that means that on average, we expect to lose 2.7 cents for every bet. It's not much compared if we bet 1 euro, but it is a decent amount. And if we would play this game a million times, we would really not expect to be walking away with any money. Now, the nice thing about the roulette game, actually the statistically nice thing, because it's not nice for people that play the game, of course, is that this is true for every possible bet you can place. If you bet on red, you exactly have the same expected value. If you bet on the first column, you exactly have the same expected value. And this might be a nice thing to practice. Why is this the case? Now, so far I talked about discrete outcomes events, so where my outcome is, say, either 1 or 2 or 3, so I either win 6 or lose 1, so there are two outcomes. But in SEM, we talk about normally distributed variables, where the outcome is any number on the range between minus infinity to infinity. So it's a continuous outcome. And that has a certain implication, namely that the probability of getting exactly the same outcome is actually zero. So the probability of getting the number, say, 1.248387, etc., 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 is exactly zero, because it could also be slightly above, slightly below, if it's truly continuous. So that's why in continuous outcomes, we don't use this probability function, but we use what's called a density function f. And this density function will give you this bell shape, for example, for the normal distribution. And it usually you can use it in mostly the same way. We can compute the expected value. We only have to replace our sum item, sum notation with an integral. And an integral you can always think about as a sum, but then in continuous space. So this is pretty much also the sum of all possible outcomes times the probability of that outcome. But we now talk in density functions. And more general, if you have a function of x, so say we have 2 times x, for example, then the expected value of the function of x can be computed by summing all possible function of x outcomes times the probability or the density that that function occurs, which is a pretty straightforward extension from the previous definition of the expected value. And this is useful. This expression alone is really useful, because with this expression we can prove a lot of things. Now, in the course, you don't have to use integrals, you don't have to know what integrals are. I just wanted to show this expression because it is a very, very useful expression. So, for example, we can prove that if our x is distributed normally, that then the expected value of x is this mu, and the variance of x is this sigma squared. And I should have written sigma of x here, not sigma squared of x, to indicate it as a standard deviation. And that's a really nice property of the normal distribution. It means we can model the mean and variance explicitly. Now, from this very useful expression, we can derive a set of rules, and these rules are very useful. So we don't need to remember this, but we can, from this, we can prove these rules. And once we know these rules, we can do a lot with expectation. And that's what's called expectation algebra. So here, x is a random variable. It has a distribution. Y is a random variable. It has a distribution. And alpha and beta are parameters, which means that they're fixed points. They're always the same. So they have no distribution. They're just one value, like a regression parameter or factor loading. And these rules follow to be the expected value of alpha, of a parameter, just is the parameter itself, because it will always be the same. The expected value of a parameter times a random variable will be that parameter times the expected value of the random variable. So the mean of 2 times x is 2 times the mean of x, which is a nice property. The expected value of a parameter times a random variable plus a parameter will simply be this. We can separate the expected value sign on this plus sign, basically split it out. So this also follows from this following rule, where the expected value of x plus y is the expected value of x plus the expected value of y. So we can split this expected value operator at this plus sign. And then finally, this one also naturally follows, where the expected value of a parameter times x plus another parameter times y equals the parameter times the expected value of x plus the other parameter times the expected value of y. Now, these rules you can just always apply, and then you can solve the expected means of a certain regression model. So, for example, the sample mean, which is simply the way that we compute the mean normally from a set of data points, is defined as 1 over the number of observations times the sum of all variables, all observations. So we can look at what the expected value is of this sample mean. And now we can show that the expected value of the sample mean equals the expected value of this whole thing. This 1 over n is a fixed parameter, so we can take it out. So that's 1 over n times the expected value of the sum. The expected value of a sum is a sum of expected values. So that's 1 over n times the sum of the expected values of y. Now these we assume to be identically distributed, which means that we assume that every this will be the same expected value. So then we could say this is simply n times that expected value of y, and that's the mean of y. So we have 1 over n times n that cancels out, times the mean of y, and that's simply the mean of y. So now we show that the expected value of our sample mean is the mean. And this is why we call this sample mean a good estimator, or an unbiased estimator, of the mean. Because its expected value is actually the mean that we're interested in. All right, so let's return to our little SEM model here. You have x causes y, and y has a residual and an intercept. So now we can derive that expected value of y equals the expected value of this expression, because y equals this. So we can just fill in this for y. That equals the expected value of the intercept plus the expected value of beta times x plus the expected value of the residual. Now the expected value of the intercept is simply the intercept because it's a parameter. The expected value of the residual, well, I defined it here, that's 0. So that falls out. And the expected value of beta times x is beta times the expected value of x. And then we get this nice expression here, tau plus beta times the mean of x. And that's half of what we showed before. Now, in SEM, we usually use matrices. So we usually use bold-faced letters instead of normal-faced letters. Uppercase letters indicating matrices, lowercase letters indicating variables. So here I have pretty much the same as I wrote before. This x now indicates a random variable, and this y indicates another random variable, a vector, so y or eta, for example. And this a and this b indicates matrices, parameters. And now the rules are pretty much the same. The expected value of the parameter matrix is simply the matrix. The expected value of a parameter matrix times a random vector is that parameter matrix times a random vector. Actually, the only difference here is that the expected value of this vector times a matrix, we have to put this matrix on back, because the order matters in matrix algebra. For the rest, it's all the same. So now, we could see that if we have y equals tau plus lambda times eta plus epsilon, so y equals an intercept plus vector loadings times the latent variable plus residual, and that's our CFA formula, and then the expected value of this equals the expected value of this expression here. We have these plus signs, so we can split this expected value on this part, these plus signs. So we get the expected value of the intercept, that's just the intercept itself, plus lambda times the expected value of eta, plus zero, because the expected value of the residual is zero, and we have tau plus lambda times alpha. And this is what we saw in the third week of SEM 1. And that's where it comes from. Now, next to the expected value, we can also look at the variance of something. So how much spread is there in the distribution? And a variance is actually defined as an expected value. So the variance of x is defined as the expected value of x minus its mean squared, where this mean here is actually the expected value again. So this is the expected value of a function of a random variable. So we can use our previously defined expression for the expected value of a function to compute this variance of a random variable. Now, again, taking a roulette board and again saying we're going to bet on this number 17, what would then be the variance and the standard deviation of our bet? Now, you could pause the video here and try to figure this out for yourself using the previously determined rule for the variance. Okay, so the variance is the function, so x minus its mean squared, times the probability for every event, and we sum that. So the mean is minus 0.027. So our outcome for winning is 35 minus minus 0.27. We square that, we multiply that with its probability, which is 1 over 37. We have a much higher probability of losing, and we would lose 1 euro. So we have 36 over 37 probability of losing 1 euro, and the function then is 1 minus its mean, that's squared. If we fill this in, we get 34.19. The standard deviation of that is the square root of it. That's usually more interpretable. So we'd have a standard deviation of 5.85. Now that's pretty high compared to this mean, which was losing 27 cents. And this is why people like these kinds of games so much, because you have a high variance. So that means you can also win a lot and you can lose a lot. And this expected value is low, but it's not that low that you would always lose immediately after the first time you play. So if you play roulette and you play 10 bets or so, you could easily win, you could easily lose, because the expected value is near zero, but the standard deviation is pretty big. So there's quite a lot of variance around it. But for the casino, where a million people might be playing, or thousands of people might be playing at the same time, and if you've ever been to Las Vegas, you will know that that's actually how many people will play these kinds of games every minute. You get to this expected value very fast. So the casino will just make money. And that's how this game works. Now the variance will be different per bet. So the variance is much lower if you bet on these colors, for example. So you could really see roulette as a game where you just pick a fixed losing rate, but you can choose yourself how much variance you have around that. So let var x indicate the variance of x, and cof x, y indicate the covariance between x and y. And we can also see the covariance is actually also an expected value. It's expected value of x minus this mean times y minus this mean. And using our previously determined rules, we could derive the following rules, which are very useful. And these rules are called covariance algebra. Where the using of these rules, I mean, is called covariance algebra. So the variance of x is actually the covariance of x with itself. That makes sense. X minus its mean times x minus mean equals x minus mean squared. And this is a very useful expression. It means that if you ever see variance of something, we can immediately write it as the covariance of something with itself, because the covariance has some really nice and interpretable rules. The covariance of a random variable with a parameter equals zero. The parameter is just a fixed point. It has no variance, so it has no covariance. The covariance of x with y equals the covariance of y with x if x and y are numbers. If they are vectors, this will be a transpose. The covariance of a parameter times x with a parameter times y equals the product of these parameters times the covariance of x and y. So we just take out these parameters and put them before the covariance operator. And this is the most useful rule. The covariance of x plus y with z equals the covariance of x with z plus the covariance of y with z. And I always see this as this sort of cell meiosis where it sort of splits up like at the plus sign. So we can split up this covariance operator at each plus sign. And this can be expanded, so the covariance of x plus y with z plus, say, w equals the covariance of x with z plus w plus the covariance of y with z plus w. And those we can then split then. So the covariance of x with z plus w equals the covariance of x with z plus the covariance of x with w. And by just repeatedly applying these rules, we can already solve a lot of problems and figure out what the implied covariance is from any model. There are some consequences of these rules. For example, here I just repeatedly apply rules. So I have the covariance of a parameter times x plus another parameter times y. I first split up on the plus sign, and then I move these parameters in front of the covariance operator. Another one that follows is this one. The variance of x plus y equals the variance of x plus the variance of y plus 2 times the covariance. And that follows from seeing that this equals the covariance of x plus y with x plus y. Then we have two plus signs. We can split it up 2 times on those plus signs. So then we get the covariance of x with x, that's the variance of x, plus the covariance of x with y, plus the covariance of y with y, that's the variance of y, plus the covariance of y with x, and that's 2 times the covariance of x with y. Finally, the variance of a parameter times a random variable equals that parameter squared times the variance of the random variable. And this again follows from this rule that the variance of beta times x equals the covariance of beta times x with beta times x. Right, so this rule here. So then we have beta twice, and then we can take it out. And that follows from this rule here. We have covariance of beta times x with beta times x. We can both take them out and we have beta times the covariance of x with x. And that is beta squared times the variance of x. So to again go back to our little SEM example, we can now derive that the variance of y equals the variance of this expression, as usual. Then this intercept will drop out, because it's a constant. So we have the variance of beta times x plus the variance of the residual. And this also shows you why we can usually ignore this mean structure if you only insert in the covariance structure, because the intercept is immediately drops out of this variance expression. So we have this covariance with the variance of beta times x plus residual. That's the covariance of beta times x plus the residual with beta times x plus the residual. And then we can split this expression up on each plus sign. So we first split it on the first plus sign. We say the covariance of beta times x with beta times x plus residual plus the covariance of the residual with beta times x plus the residual. And then we can split these two again on the plus sign. So we get the covariance of beta times x with beta times x plus the covariance of beta times x with the residual plus the covariance of the residual with beta times x plus the covariance of the residual with the residual. That's a lot, but we can simplify this. And that's because the covariance of x with the residual is zero by definition. That this is not correlated with x, so that covariance is zero. Here we can see that this beta we can take out, and then it would be the variance of x. So this reads beta squared times the variance of x. And this covariance of epsilon with epsilon is simply the variance of epsilon. Now, if we then fill in these parameters, we would see that the variance of y equals beta squared times the variance of x, that is sigma x squared, plus the variance of the residual, which we call theta here. And there we have the expression for the variance. Now, we can take this and make this as complicated as we want. So we could expand this and make this like a bigger system, where x now causes y1 and y1 causes y2. So the model for y1 equals beta1 times x1 plus the residual, but the model for y2 equals beta2 times y1 plus the residual, and that's y1 here, we can fill in this expression here. So we get beta2 times, and then this expression for y1 plus the residual. We can again look at the amount of observations we have. I ignored the mean structure here, because it would just be two intercepts, or three, one mean for x, two intercepts, and three means. And we can see that we have a variance here that I did not draw. That's pretty typical for exogenous variables. 1, 2, 3, 4 parameters. So 5 parameters in total, including this variance. We have 6 observations because we have 3 variances and 3 covariances. So we would have a degree of freedom here. And now we can compute all kinds of interesting things. So we could compute, for example, the implied covariance between x on the left here and y2 on the right here. And simply following the rules repeatedly, we will see that that covariance equals beta 1 times beta 2 times sigma x squared, the variance of x. And that follows from these rules. Now in the first practical, we will simply practice with this for 2 hours. In the first lecture, I will then show you easier ways to get this. We don't actually need to do this to compute this covariance, but we can always confirm our results with this useful toolset of covariance algebra. Now finally, in SEM, we usually use vectors and matrices. So to expand this covariance algebra again to multivariate problems, we can make everything bold-faced again. And actually the rules don't change that much. There's only one little change. The variance of x equals the covariance of x with itself. X is now a vector. The only change is here. The covariance of a times x with b times y equals a times the covariance of x with y times b transpose. We put this b in the back. And one thing to note here is that the variance of x, or the variance of a vector, is a covariance matrix, a variance covariance matrix. So this could be, for example, sigma. And in the univariate case, we can simply put this parameter here before, because if there are numbers, it doesn't matter. But for matrices, it does. The order really matters for the matrix algebra. So we put this A in front, everything on the left of the column we put in front, everything on the right we put in the back, transposed. And from that we can see, for example, this result. So the variance of b times x equals the covariance of b times x with b times x. We put one b in front, one b transpose in the back. And again, the covariance can be split on the plus sign. Now from this, we could derive, for example, this expression, where y equals an intercept plus a vector Lonergan matrix times a latent variable plus residual. Right? And now these are matrices and vectors. So the variance of this, which we call sigma, equals the variance of this intercept plus the vector Lonergan matrix times the latent variable plus residual. Intercept drops out because it's a constant. The residual and the latent variable are uncorrelated from each other, just like we saw before already here. So this will follow to be the variance of lambda times eta with the variance plus the variance of the residual. That will follow to be lambda times the variance of eta times lambda transpose plus the variance of the residual. And if you call this psi and this theta, then we get lambda times psi times lambda transpose plus theta. And that's what we have been seeing in SEM1 pretty much every week. Now in SEM2, it will be the same thing. The only thing that we're going to do on the first lecture is add one more matrix here, because we're also going to model regression effects between these latent variables. And it will follow thus we have one more expression here, and it will naturally follow from this covariance algebra as well. All right, that's it for this video lecture, and I'll see you all in the first practical.